Sister Lucy Curran is the founder and director of Maher, a community and interfaith organization for abused and destitute women and children, headquartered in Pune, India. She was born in Kerala province, and Sister Lucy moved to Mumbai with her family to access better education. She understood the conditions of the poor and decided that she was going to become a nun and joined the Holy Cross Order, which focused on teaching and nursing. She, however, was inspired by Mother Teresa, and she felt a knowing to be closer to the people, that she wanted to directly touch the lives. And in 1989, she joined the HOPE organization founded by the Holy Cross. And in 1991, while she was there, she had a very profound encounter, which she will share with us this morning. This 46 places of refuge are all over India. Maher helps destitute women, children, regardless of caste, creed, or religion. It took 7 years to get the support that she needed, with not a single dollar from the government or any other organization. People came forward. So now they house 860 street children, more than 300 destitute women, including 120 mentally ill women picked up from the side of the roadside because nobody wanted them. 71 mentally ill destitute men also live in these homes. They provide immediate shelter and intervention and long-term community for these individuals. Her journey, again, has taken her all around the world, sharing this message. She had a special introduction to Pope Francis, who blessed her and thanked her and told her that the good work she was doing was making a difference. A final piece of Sister Lucy is this. We respect and love all religions. We never put down anyone's religion or uphold one religion to the exclusion of others. What we want is to believe and respect interfaith religion, inclusive of any faith tradition. And in our community's spiritual practices, we invoke prayers to the divine rather than invoking any particular name or form of God to the exclusion of others. So it is with great Vancouver welcome that she is here today, Sister Lucy Curran.
Good morning. In India, we normally say Namaste. I think we can be a little bit relaxed because the story that I'm going to tell you may horrify you, so please bear with me. Before I go into the incident that which made me to start this organization, maybe I will speak to you a little bit of my personal journey. I'm sorry, Janet, how much time we have, Janet? 20 minutes, 10 minutes?
25 minutes.
Oh, great, okay. I want to thank you for the beautiful prayer, Mr. Bruce. I don't know how you address, Minister? Oh, yeah, thank you so much. And also all the beautiful singers, thank you for putting us into that great mood. Thank you so much. And I also want to say thank you to my friends who are here, Gillian and Elizabeth, for driving me all the way from there, from US to hear. It is my first experience in Canada. So, thank you. And I thought I will have trouble at the border, but it was so nice. Wow. And I had a great welcome by the policeman, so it was very nice. Thank you. Yeah. So I am here and I thank you. And the main instrument for bringing me to this place is Mr. Will Kippin and Janet. And so thank you so much for doing that. And I thank you for each one of you for giving me this opportunity to share the share my work here. So as I said, I'll go back to my little the story, how my childhood days. Those of you have been to India, you will understand the state of Kerala, which means the state of Kerala is much more developed than the other states of India. That's a state where we had 100% literacy. I grew up in that state. But the place that I was growing up, the village that I was growing up, we did not have the high school. We only had up to the, I don't know how you call it, the seventh grade or, yeah. So after that, I could not continue my schooling because we were 9 siblings in my home. And my parents could not afford us to send us to a boarding school. If I told we wanted to go, we had to go to a boarding school, which I could not go. And as a child, I traveled to Bombay with some nuns. And when I reached Bombay, I saw the slums for the first time. You know, those days when I was growing up in my village, we did not have a newspaper, nor a TV, nor radio. So I had no clue what other places of India looked like or going to be like for me. And I thought my little mini Kerala was everywhere. And when I reached Bombay, I saw the population and the women sitting on the roadside for toilet and things like that. I saw the slums. I just couldn't understand what's going on. And after some time, I started thinking, why people are not helping the poor? And I did not know. And I saw very close to the place where I was staying was Mother Teresa's home. Since I was feeling homesick because I had left my small brothers and sisters and I was feeling very homesick, I used to run to the Mother Teresa's to play with the children. And also, I did not know at that time what is called volunteering. So I used to go there. My English is very poor. My English is only by, as I told you, I'm not educated. So it's only by hearing I have learned English. So if you don't understand me, please stop me and ask again because I know it is not good, okay? But if you don't follow me, please put your hand up and I will repeat again. So what happened was that I went to Mother Teresa's place sometimes to play with the children, but I understood nothing. And then the Mother Teresa sisters, you know, this child was picked up from the dustbin. This child was found on the street, things like that, okay? And at the age of 14, I saw Mother Teresa for the first time. And there was a grand welcome at the place in the convent where she was, one of the branches of Bombay. And I saw from far away, I looked at her, I said, oh, this is the lady who has put up all this, you know, and that's it. And I completely forgot because, you know, when you are young, you are attracted to this world, and especially Bombay, where we can get everything and friends, boyfriends, whatever it was, okay? And I was involved in that kind of things. And then at the age of 18, I said, I wanted to join a congregation. I don't know why, because there was a pull between my life in the world and also the spiritual life. Something was pulling me, but I could not understand what it was. And I decided I will go to Mother Teresa's because Mother Teresa's sisters were accepting the non-educated girls. So I thought, oh, that's easy, then I can go to them. And also, I like the work. So when I went there and I filled up the form, they gave me a form because they knew me already. So they easily gave me the form. And they told me, no, Lucy, your parents have to sign. So, those days it used to take 4 days to reach to my place from Bombay to Kerala. And I traveled to home, and I told my parents, I'm going to Mother Teresa's. So my parents looked at me and, you know, they found it very strange. And what is she talking about? You know, that... And my mother said, do you understand what you are talking? I said, yes, yes, I've been working with them. And my mother said, no, because what they had heard, that Mother Teresa was picking up leprosy patients. And my parents were so concerned that I will get leprosy. And they said, no, no way you can go. So, okay, I give up that idea. I came back to Bombay, continued working. And then I came across a congregation called Holy Cross. And I found there was no leprosy patient, so I told my mother. Of course, they didn't give me permission. With my insistence, I went to the congregation and I joined there. I worked with them for 9 years. And then I found that I was, you know, not the place that I wanted to be. I wanted to do something. But here I was, I landed in the congregation where there was only teaching and in nursing. Of course, we had a small boardings, etc. But our life was not touching the real poor, what I wanted to do. And while I was there, then they gave me permission to go and work in a village home of our congregation. So I went there. I was transferred there. While I was working in this one of the village branches of our congregation, a woman approached me for shelter. We were giving training, etc. that time. And she approached me for shelter. Now, those of you, I don't know, maybe some of you have the Catholic background. So when you are in a Catholic convent or monastery, whatever it is, we are not allowed to take somebody from inside, from outside, inside, just like that. So I went to my, asked permission to keep her, but no, they said, no, you cannot keep, and things like that. So we had to send her back. And this particular woman, she was 7 months pregnant, who had approached me for shelter. She told me that her husband is in love with another woman. He's an alcoholic, he's a hot-tempered, and she told me the whole story. And I knew that whatever story she was telling me was a genuine story, but how to help her out was a big question. And I told her, you come back the next day, because I thought, no, I will ask some people and see how I can help her. But unfortunately, what happened was that that day never came for her. Her husband and she, they must have had some fight. I don't know exactly what happened. He poured kerosene and set her on fire. And I heard the shouting and yelling because this happened very close to the house. You know, it's just a small street between us. Like any other onlooker, I also reached there. And when I reached there, I realized it was the same case because she was shouting, help me, you know, in Hindi, those of you understand, mujhe bachao, mujhe bachao. And then I reached there and I was utterly shocked because hair was burnt, her sari is all burning. I just did not know what to do. Anyway, with the help of the people, I managed to reach her to the hospital. It took us quite some time because the convent that I was living in, we did not have a car, nor the people around us, anybody had a car. So it took a while to even to reach her to the hospital. Nothing. There was no public transport. It was in a village. And finally, by the time we reached her to the hospital, doctor told me that she is already 90% burnt. Then I asked doctor if anything can be done to save the baby because as I told you all, she was 7 months pregnant. When doctor took her to the operation theater, what we got in our hand was a fully burnt baby or fully cooked baby. And I was completely, you know, broken or I don't know what I could say about myself. I was really blaming myself for the death of the two people. I came home, I could not sleep, and I was so angry with myself and also with the rules that were there and things like that. And I grew up with that kind of, what shall I call it, you know, this feeling of anger inside me because all these things were frustrating me. And you know, there was a time when the so we had a set up a table, and I felt like turning that table upside down. So angry I was, because I was all the time looking at the children who are begging, women who are on the street, things like that. And here I'm having a good breakfast. I couldn't understand, what am I doing, you know? So, and I was all the time questioning myself for what I had come, and now what am I doing? You know, so this kind, the frustration was getting into me more and more. And then my friends noticed that I was becoming an angry person, because I was never like that. I was a very joyful person. And here I am turning something else. So my friends noticed and said, Lucy, you need to go for some counseling because you are not the same. I also realized that. So I went in for counseling. Fortunately for me, he was a Catholic priest, a very open-minded man. And though he was a Catholic priest, he used to teach Bhagavad Gita, Hinduism, and not only in India and also to other European countries. So when I went to him, of course I was there with him for several times, and then he told me, Lucy, instead of waiting for the convent to do something for the poor, why don't you do it? Oh my God, I said, does this priest know that, you know, doesn't know that I'm a nun, I have no money, I have no education, and what am I going to do? And I even thought he's crazy. And then after some time, when, you know, he told me, Lucy, if you have love in your heart, you can do it. Oh, that struck me very much, and I came back and I started thinking about it. Then I started writing letter to my authorities saying that I want to do something about it. But they called me and they advised me, they're saying, Lucy, you know, this is a lot of work and a lot of money. We cannot do this. But then I was insistent, saying that work I will do. We have to do it, things like that. But they could not understand my inner calling. So they told me, no, no. Then finally I said, okay, then can I leave the congregation so that I can do it? You know, that way I thought. Then, of course, the nuns did not want me to go because, you know, by the time I had a good reputation in the convent. And they did not want me to go because other nuns will ask why she left. So things like that. So then they said, no, no, what do? You remain a member of the congregation, but the work that you want to do will not belong to the congregation. So they took an MOU from me saying that you will remain a member of the congregation, but the work will not belong, so I have to sign all the documents. I don't know from where I had the courage. I signed it, and I moved. But fortunately for me, since I was staying in that village set up, the convent, they had not asked me to get out. So I was staying there and planning what I could do. And the first man I came across was through this same priest, from a man from Austria. He helped me. He came down with his son because they are whole family, they are musicians. And then they said, Lucy, we can conduct many programs and send you the money, because he had heard about me. And I think the same priest had spoken. So he said, tell me what you want to do. So I told that if I have a home, I will rescue these women, things like that. So he liked the idea. Before leaving India, they gave me some money. And that was enough for me to buy a small piece of land. Will and Gillian and Elizabeth will tell you how big is our plot. It is a small plot, and we bought a small piece of land, and I built the first home. I was able to build up the first home only in 1997. After that, I started taking the women, taking the children, and thousands of women have been through Maher. More than 4,000 women have been through Maher. Same way, women means also children. I didn't understand that at that time. You know, when we are not married, when we remain single, we don't understand that women means also children. And I didn't think anything for the children at that time. I only thought of for women. And then along with the women, every woman walked in with the children. I said, oh my God, now what shall I do? The house was overfull. That small house was already filled with 70 children. I said, oh my God, now what shall I do? And with two toilets. And I said, yeah. So I started thinking, what shall I do? But before that, I had an experience. I said, oh, food and shelter, yes, but what is the type of spirituality that I can offer to these children? Now, I am coming from a very traditional Catholic family, and then after that the convent training. So I knew only the Catholic prayers and the type of spirituality. And I said, these women who are coming, they are coming all from different faith. We had people from Buddhist background, Islam, Christianity, Hindus, majority were the Hindus. And I said, oh my God, what shall I teach them? How shall I lead them into spiritual life? I could not understand that. And one night, I don't know, can you just hold this, Jillian, for me? So this particular banner came into my mind. You will see this in, can you just lift it up a little? Yeah. You will see this banner in every home of us. And I put the light here. You know, like every religion is teaching us to go to the divine inside us. So I put the light as representing the divine. So every religion is teaching us to go to the divine. So what I did, thank you, Jillian. Yeah. So what I did was that all our songs we were addressing to the divine, not taking any particular name of any god. But if you come during Christmas, you may think I still converted them into Christianity. And if you come during Diwali, you may think they all are Hindus. And if you come during Eid, you may think they all the children are the Muslims, because they dress up that way and things. We have a lot of fun about it, more than, I think for children, for more than spirituality, it's the fun, okay? But then we have a lot of spirituality around all the festival that we celebrate. Every festival we celebrate. Because for children, the more festivities are there, it's better for them. So then that's how we started sharing the spirituality. And the children sit in for meditation for some time. Maybe when it is only for children, we have it very short for 5 minutes meditation. And then they are singing a song. And afterwards, the children make a spontaneous prayer. Now, when I come to spontaneous prayer, I want to tell you one of the incidents that happened in our home. My name is so much Christian for India. Okay, so people thought that I have come there for conversion, converting people to Christianity. And church thought, because I was wearing this particular medal, which is already in the faith, and the church thought I had left the church. So I was in the middle of nowhere. Okay, and the people around thought that I had come for conversion. So people even came to, they spat on me when I used to walk on the street. They would never stop the public vehicle because I'm a Christian. And then people even came to kill me. So there was a time when people came around, and fortunately, that particular day, I was not there. I had gone to the village. And it was 7:30, that's the time for the evening prayer. And the children were sitting around. And they saw all these uncles are coming inside. And normally the children are used to getting donors. So they thought they are the donors. So they sang happy welcome. And after that, they sat for prayer. And they were saying the same prayer. And a child normally makes a spontaneous prayer. And in that prayer, the children said, now they had no clue why these uncles had come. Because we call them uncles, okay? Anybody who is little older than us, we call them dada or uncle. We are not... In Indian culture, we are not supposed to take the name of the person. So children thought all these uncles are come to donate. So four things, they sat with a joined hand, eyes closed, and they were praying, dear God, bless all these uncles who are come, give peace in their heart, joy in their family, things like that, okay? And they had only heard rumors that I'm converting, but they had not come inside our house. When they came inside the house, they saw, you know, in our main sanctuary, we have the Quran, the Bible, the Bhagavad Gita, this particular, and also the pictures of Ganesh, Buddha, Jesus, everybody there. Okay, so when they came, they looked at all round, because they had not come inside the house. It was a first visit for them, and they came inside. And they got a bit confused what it's all going about and going on. And then they listened to the children's prayer. And after that, you know, it's an Indian custom that we offer tea to anybody who comes. Because like in your country, we don't have all those drinks, you know, orange juice and that juice, because that's very expensive for us. The simple thing that we give to the people is the tea. So we had children, the bigger children had kept tea on the fire, and they invited all these uncles to come to our tea. And so just then I reached. And I also said, come, it's for tea. So then we offered the tea, and some of them were not taking. They were so stern. I said, what did I do to these people? Why are they so grumpy? I don't know, so not smiling. But and I was smiling from here to there, but they were not smiling. But I tried my level to smile, make them smile, but they were not. But it was something. And but after the tea, and they asked me many questions, how you are come and what, who are these children, everything they asked me. And I don't know the local language, okay? I don't know the local customs. I was also learning at that time. And they asked me many questions. I tried to answer them everything. And one by one, they all left. And there was one person who was, evening it was, okay? He was drunk. And you know, when you are drunk, sometimes you speak the truth. So what happens that, you know, he told me, you know, we had come to finish you up, but now we are going converted in our heart. Okay. So I didn't understand what he said. I thought he's drunk, so he's talking nonsense. I didn't understand. After some time, when they were going out, they were picking up some things. And our children saw that. And our children came and told me, Didi, see, they have got a hockey stick and they have got axe and things like that. I think they have come to harm us. So then I realized what this man had said, this drunkard. Okay? That's the time then I put the thing together. Okay? But, you know, when the divine wants you to do something, nothing happens to us. And that's it. And they went away. After that, I did not have, I mean, serious problems. But people still keep asking me, are you come for conversion? Wherever I open the homes. So I said, in 1997, we opened our first home. Now we have 46 homes in various parts of India. It's okay. Not only in Pune, but we have in other states, and a lot of invitation comes to us. But before that, I want to give you one small story, because this happened just the day when I was leaving. I left India on the 12th of this month. So I just want to tell you on the 11th what happened. There was a young boy in one of our homes. And he was, you know, he was picked up by the Don Bosco fathers, and he was very troublesome. He was from the street, and then very, very troublesome. So since they could not handle, they called up to the government people and said, we cannot handle this boy, and he's giving trouble. So they sent the boy, the government people, sent them to another organization. After 6 months, they too got a call. From there to there, had a call saying that it's impossible to deal with this boy. Please take him away. So then they said, oh, call up to Sister Lucy. And then they called me up. I said, okay, send him. And I did not ask what is his background. I just took him. And of course, after he came to our house, we realized that he is really creating problem. And each time the staff used to tell me, you know, he's creating so much problem. Every time I used to speak to this little boy and I said, Rahul, you know that I love you, but don't create so much problem and things like that. And whenever I went to that home, all that I did was to hug him and give him a kiss. This is what I did. And what happened was, when he was in the junior college, you know, the teenagers, okay, when he came home from the college, he was very hungry. What he did was that he opened the refrigerator and he found a nice cake sitting there. Somebody had come and they had offered a cake for all our children. And now, his name is Rahul. Rahul saw this cake. He took that cake and he cut half. You know, he's a young boy. He can eat that whole cake. But he was decent enough to cut it half and he ate. So when the cook came in, he saw that he was eating cake. And he said, Rahul, how can you do this? This is for all. So they must have had some argument. So, you know, Rahul, give one slap to the cook. Okay. Now, that touched, I mean, harmed, the ego of this man. And he went to the office and said, I resign. I'm not going to do this work. Whole day we are working for these children and we have to get slaps from them. I'm not going to take it. So, okay. Then the staff made him want to understand and anyway. But the staff was also full with this Rahul up to here because he was creating problem. And they were also waiting for a chance when they can throw him out. So then they called me up. And they said, Didi, it's enough now. Now you have to do something. And because every time I should say no, understand, have patience, he will change, things like that. But then they told me, no, now this is enough. Okay. So I took the flight, I went there, and I spoke to the staff and I said, supposing if one of our child has to do that, what will we do? We throw him out? And some other staff said, yes, I will throw him out, and things like that, okay. Then I said, no, but I think there is another way. Shall we show him little more compassion, love? And I prepared this staff very well. Whole day I've been talking, discussing. Okay, finally, you know, I made the hearts of my staff a little soft. And not I did not do, the divine did it. I was only instrumental, I can say. And then Rahul had gone to college and he came back. When he came back, he saw me, he put his head down and he walked. Then I said, I went round there and I took him like this and I said, Rahul, why is your head down? Of course he knew. And he had come prepared because now this is going to be the last day for him in Maher. Because that means I'm come there to throw him out because the staff had told him, let Didi come and we'll throw you out. Okay. So he had come prepared in his mind that this is going to be his last day. So when I went there and I felt so sad for him, so what I did was that I first I hugged him like that and I gave him a kiss. I said, Rahul, we all make mistake. We are human. But what you should have said is say sorry to the staff. He said, I said sorry, but they did not take. And the way he had said sorry was, sorry. So naturally the staff did not take that, okay? And I said, I think there is a better way of saying sorry, okay? And that is how you can be. And before that, the staff asked me even, you choose between Rahul or we, okay? And I said, I will choose Rahul. Because then they felt so frustrated with me because they said, Didi, what are you doing? Because so many children are there, 70 children. So I said, no, because you all have a home. And if I send you all back, you all will find a job, you have a home. But where will Rahul go? On the street? I said, no way. So I will still love him. So I had prepared. And then the staff knew, no way they can do anything to me. So, okay, they have to become soft. And so what happened when Rahul came in, and I hugged him, I said, Rahul, I think there's a nice way of saying sorry. And when I kissed him, you know, I hugged him. Young man, he was holding his self so tight like that. And I said, make yourself little soft, I want to kiss you. And I hugged him tight, he had no way to go from me. And the way I held like that, okay, then he started crying. When he started crying, the staff also felt so bad. Then I said, see Rahul, there's no way you are going to be out. If you are going out, I'm also coming with you. I spoke that kind of a language to him. You won't believe what happened to him. He completed his studies. He joined Indian Army. And the first salary he brought on the 11th of this month. We are in October, okay? I have a problem. So in October, he came with this first salary to me. Okay, so that was one of the challenges. And of course, I have many, many stories, okay? But this I'm telling you because this is so new, because it's happened on the 11th before I could move to US. And I was really touched. And you know, when he was giving the salary, he told me, he said, Didi, you know what has changed me? It's only your hug and your kiss changed me, he said. He said, I had thought that if you had to throw me out that day, I would join a terrorist group and I will learn to shoot and I will do something to all this stuff. He didn't say exactly the words, I will shoot, but he said, I will do something to this stuff. That's what he decided. But after I did that, you know, that whole entire thing changed in him, and he became such a good human being. I can't believe that, you know, this is the thing that has changed him. So I was so happy, you know, that the Divine gave me the wisdom at that time to take him to another path in that sense, okay? I have, of course, several stories that time. I think we are having some workshop. We will have more stories at that time. It's not going to be a workshop, okay? I am not so familiar with the workshop because in America and in Canada, we are so used to that word work, no? So I think we will change it into pleasure, okay? So we can have something like that, okay? So thank you for inspiration. And also, if you all have any question, you can ask me or you can ask Bill, Cynthia, Janet, and all my friends who are here. Yes. If you want to donate, yeah. Yeah, U.S., it's okay, no? U.S. Mahir Friends, you can send there. It's a U.S.-based non-profit organization. You can send it. Bill, can you explain that? Maybe?
Yeah, it's just a foundation, that a U.S. 501c3 that you can donate to, and they'll give a tax receipt, at least for U.S. donations. It's usmaherfriends.org, right?
No, U.S. Mahir Friends.
U.S. Mahir Friends, yeah. Yeah, and you can just Google
yes,
it.
Yes,
can
you also go to the website?
You can also donate, yeah, through the Mahir website.
Yeah.
That's right. That might be better, actually, for Canadians.
I will put the papers there, yeah. Oh, thank you.